మీరు కలీగ్స్ డాక్టర్ అంజయ్య గారు అండ్ వ్యూవర్స్ ఆన్ యూట్యూబ్ ఓయూసీఐపి యూట్యూబ్ ఛానల్ ఐ వెల్కమ్ యూ ఆల్ ఫర్ ద 17th లెక్చర్ ఆఫ్ ఓయూసీఐపి వెరీ గుడ్ ఈవినింగ్ అండ్ వార్మ్ వెల్కమ్ టు యూ ఆల్ ద ఉస్మాన్ యూనివర్సిటీ సెంటర్ ఫర్ ఇంటర్నేషనల్ ప్రోగ్రామ్స్ ఓయూసీఐపి has initiated a year long program called Tuesday Talk. As part of the Tuesday Talk, this is the 17th lecture. Really, the viewers of OUCAP YouTube channel, we are privileged to invite an eminent speaker, a great social scientist from Usman University, Professor Adappa Satyanarayana sir. Professor Adappa Satyanarayana is a retired professor, Department of History, Usman University. He obtained many degrees. He got DPhil degree in South Asian History from Heidelberg University, Germany. And he joined the department, that is Department of History, in the year 1984. And he served at various levels for about 30 years. During his academic career, Professor Adappa published more than 60 research articles and 10 books. His area of expertise is the socio-economic history of modern India, particularly with a focus on marginalized history and subaltern history. Professor Adappa Satyanarayana sir has many achievements and number of fellowships, awards, visiting professorships by many universities in India and abroad. Yes. In fact, Professor Adappa Satyanarayana sir requires no introduction. His critical thinking and his ideas, the way he looks at the Indian history, is unique. He has the keen observation on the ancient history to the modern history. Under his able guidance, 14 students got PhD degree and he guided 15 MPhil dissertations. He has written and edited many books, include Economy, Society and Polity, different books. Especially Professor Adappa Satyanarayana is known for marginalized studies. He is the man in the Department of History after many decades. It's not an exaggeration. He is called Romila Thafer of Department of History of Usman University. He got many awards, State Best Meritorious Teacher Award in 2009 by joint Andhra Pradesh government. He was nominated member for many academic, administrative and research bodies. He was a nominated member for Indian Council of Historical Research from 2008 to 2014. That was part of MHRD. And he worked as academic advisor to the Telangana Public Service Commission for the period of 3 years. And most of his students are now the teachers of various universities in the state of Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, in general, and particularly at the central universities. Dr. Anjaya is here, senior academician who served for the university for many years. He was also a scholar of Professor Adappa Satyanarayana. This shows his commitment and his service to the university and his service to the student community. Today, Professor Adappa is going to talk on evaluation of composite culture in India and historical perspectives. As we know, the OUCAP has been conducting so many lectures on variety of subjects. This is the first of its type. After having a lot of subjects, the OUCAP thought that there should be diversity in the subjects. Immediately, our concentration went to 2-3 academicians. Professor Adappa Satyanarayana sir is one among a few and a unique academicians in the Usman University campus. The essence of Indian society and civilization throughout the ages has been pluralism and multiculturalism. Professor Adappa Satyanarayana sir is going to talk about various things and establishments from the British rule to modern times. And he also tried to look at the role of social reformers from the period Raja Ramon Rai to Mahatma Jyotiba Phule, Ramaswamy Nayakar, Baba Saheb Ambedkar, Savitribai Phule, and other social reformers who are the gems of the soils of the soil, who are sons and daughters of the soil. Definitely, today's lecture is going to be one of a unique lecture in this lecture series. Now, may I invite our eminent speaker, Professor Adappa sir, to deliver his valuable talk. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Nayesh Rao, for inviting me to deliver this lecture to your audience and participants. I know Dr. Nayesh Rao has been a dynamic scholar who has been promoting academic activities in the center with all seriousness. And I have been following in the last couple of months the various programs that have been undertaken under his leadership. When he asked me to talk about a topic, then I realized a topic which should be appealing to all scholars cutting across the disciplinary boundaries. A topic which is truly interdisciplinary or multidisciplinary. Because I know OUCAP undertakes various programs which are not strictly confined to any one particular discipline. So therefore, I thought I would like to reflect on the core of Indian civilization or the essence of our culture. That is composite culture in India through ages. It's also relevant in the present context because now there is a tendency to equate culture with one religion, or in the name of cultural nationalism, a particular viewpoint is projected which would exclude the other cultures, which are, for example, non-Hindu or non-Brahmanic or non-Vedic. So therefore, I thought I would like to reflect on the evolution of Indian civilization through the ages. I am sort of taking a long durée approach, trying to understand how the composite culture evolved in Indian history, from the ancient past to the present. So therefore, in the coming 40 to 50 minutes, I would like to focus on the core elements of the Indian civilization. First and foremost, we must remember, or to sort of, to say what is composite culture. Composite culture meant a heterogeneous mixture of multiple cultures meeting and coexisting in one single region or nation. That is the heterogeneity and the coexistence are the defining characteristic features of the composite culture. The term composite culture also means culture drawn from various strands. You know, it could be further defined as the fusion of amalgamation of different cultures and traditions forming a new distinct cultural tradition. That is to say that Indian culture evolved by amalgamating the various other cultures from outside, so to speak. When I say India, I broadly mean the Indian subcontinent, or in the ancient past, in the texts, you know, we call it as the Bharatavarsha or Bharatakanda. And from time immemorial, India was never an isolated region or isolated country. It has always been interacting with other cultures outside the territorial and geographical boundaries of what we call the Bharatakanda. So therefore, it is very important to remember that Indian culture evolved in a context in which there was interaction, interpenetration between different cultures. We all know, as per the recorded history, the earliest civilization of India is called the Indus Valley Civilization. The Indus Valley Civilization flourished from about 3000 BC. And it was during the period of the Indus Valley Civilization that India had contacts with the outside world. The Indus Valley people had commercial relations, trade relations, cultural relations with what we today call West Asia or the Gulf countries or the Middle Eastern countries. And the Indian products, Indian commodities were exported throughout the West Asian countries and also as far as the Roman civilization in Europe. Because Indus Valley civilization was a contemporaneous civilization, of the other great world civilizations that flourished in Babylonia, in Greece, in Italy, in China, in Mesopotamia, and so on. So therefore, Indus Valley civilization was contemporaneous with other great civilizations. Therefore, there had been interpenetration of ideas, interpenetration of commodities, and interpenetration of people. So therefore, the very fact that India was in the midst of a context, a global context, in which the Indian commodities, Indian ideas, Indian culture had been exposed to the outside world. So this is a very, very unique feature that we must understand, that India was never an isolated entity. It was part of the larger world, so to speak. If I use the modern term globalization, there was a globalization in the ancient past. If globalization meant the exchange of commodities, the establishment of trade and commercial relations. So Indus Valley people had trade and commercial relations with the rest of the world, so to speak, particularly with Rome, with West Asia, and with other countries. So therefore, it is interesting to note that from the ancient past, from time immemorial, India was incorporated into the larger world. It interacted with various other cultures, with various other peoples. And therefore, Indus Valley people people had contacts with the rest of the world. I think this is very, very important. This is a founding stage, so to speak, of the evolution of the Indian culture. And the Indus Valley people had been the most accomplished in the world insofar as their skills were concerned. The trade, commerce, the handicrafts that were produced, they were all world famous. I must tell you, India was the first country in the world to export cotton. India produced cotton. Indian textiles, Indian cotton textiles were in great demand in other civilizations, like in the Greco-Roman civilization, and the Indian textiles were exported to different parts of the world. India was the exporter of cotton textiles. India was known for its production of cotton. Therefore, that commodity which brought recognition to India, just as today in the 20th century and 21st century, we claim that our software, our computer technology has brought recognition to India. So in the 21st century, in the 20th century, India is known for its software skills, but in the ancient past, India was known for its cotton textiles and known for its craftsmen. Its craftsmen, the weavers, the potters, the sculptors, the producers who had acquired recognition all over the world of their skills. So therefore, Indian cotton textiles, Indian products were in greater demand in the rest of the world. So therefore, as I said, India was part of the international trade and commerce. India was incorporated with the rest of the world, so to speak. So therefore, it is important to understand that the Indus Valley people had acquired certain skills, certain cultural forms from the other religions, from other cultures, because they interacted. Similarly, after the decline of the Indus Valley civilization, we had the Vedic civilization. The Vedic civilization followed the Indus Valley civilization. The Vedic civilization was basically a rural civilization, whereas Indus Valley civilization was an urban civilization, known for its handicrafts. The goldsmiths who produced fine ornaments during the Indus Valley civilization, which were exported. India exported ornaments and India exported cotton textiles. So therefore, the Indian skills, Indian craftsmen were known all over the world. Similarly, during the Vedic civilization, the people who created the Vedic civilization were called the Aryans. These are the people who are the nomadic people who came on horseback from the European steppes through Central Asia, through the Hindu Kush mountains, and settled in what is called in the valley of Ganga Yamuna, Doab, Ganga Sindhu Maidan we call. So the Ganges Valley was the cradle of the Vedic civilization. So these Aryans came, they were pastoral people. Of course, they defeated the local people and established a civilization, as we call the early Vedic civilization, which was fully described in the Rig Veda. So the Vedic literature, the four Vedas, as well as the Samhita literature, later the Aryankanas, the Upanishads, etc., provide us the essence of the Vedic civilization. Suffice it to say that when the Aryans came, they came as pastoralists, they came on horseback, they were nomadic people, and they settled here and they encouraged agriculture. Pastoralism and agriculture was developed during the Indus Valley civilization, during the Vedic civilization. So the Vedic culture therefore incorporated certain elements from outside also, because these Aryans who came from what we call the Eastern Europe, steppes, through Central Asia, including Iran, Iraq, Afghanistan, and settled in northwestern India, what we today call the present-day Pakistan and present-day Punjab. So that was the cradle of the Vedic civilization. So Vedic people, Vedic culture, as it was recorded in the Rig Veda, the Vedic literature, the Vedic culture has some similarities with other great civilizations of the world. For example, the Jewish religion, as well as the Persian religion, the Persian culture, has so many elements which were similar to the Vedic civilization. And therefore, during the ancient past, the Indian culture had interacted, or there was interface between the Central Asian countries, what we today call Iran, Iraq, Mesopotamia, Babylonia, then Greek, you know, Rome, the world's most famous civilizations, they had interacted with the Indian culture and Indian civilization. So Vedic people were a kind of an intermediary between the Indian culture and the European culture, so to speak, or the non-Indic cultures. So therefore, there are so many elements that were present in the Vedic civilization, which were found in Mesopotamia, in Babylonia, in Persia, in Judaism, and so on and so forth. So therefore, the fact that the Aryans came from outside, got mingled with the local people, got absorbed into the Indian society, and brought with them their traditions and customs, and therefore the Vedic culture, the Vedic civilization evolved both during the early Vedic period as well as the later Vedic period. And by this time, of course, India had also witnessed another important development in cultural and religious terms, particularly the 6th century BC, when it was almost during the later Vedic period that we find that certain developments which were taking place, which provided a kind of a cultural synthesis. And soon after, the Vedic civilization flourished and got absorbed into the Indian civilization, Indian cultural milieu. Various elements from the other cultures were very much present. And in the 6th century BC, a great cultural upheaval had taken place due to certain social evils that crept into the Vedic civilization. By the time of the later Vedic period, there are certain elements within the Vedic culture, or what is called the Brahmanism, Vedic Brahmanism, which had certain negative features. Because we must remember, when we talk about Indian civilization, we do not talk in terms of religious identity or ethnic identity or a linguistic identity as such. When we talk about Vedic culture, Vedic civilization, we talk in terms of its essence, not identified with any one particular religious identity or linguistic identity or ethnic identity. This we must remember. Indian civilization is not equated with any one single religion. So therefore, there is no word. The word called Hindu did not occur in the Vedic literature. There is no word called Hindu in the Vedic literature, either in the Rig Veda or in the later Vedic literature. It is broadly known as the Sanatana Dharma or the Brahmanism, or what the famous Indian historian Romila Thapar called it as Brahmanism. So the Brahmanism or the Vedic culture was the predominant culture by the time of the 6th century BC. But what happened was, in the 6th century BC, certain, what you call, shortcomings were found in the religious and the cultural practices. For example, the priestly class, the Brahmins, became dominant. And they justified the social inequalities. So the so-called Dvijas, the Brahmanas, the Kshatriyas, and the Vaishyas, began to assert their authority over the others. The Sudras were looked down. And in the religious practices, the Yagas and the Yagnas, and there were some deviations from the ideal principles of the religion. So therefore, the 6th century BC was a period in which the Brahmanical religion, or the Brahmanism, what Romila Thapar called, gained upper hand, and it led to the social evils. Like, for example, the women were relegated to the secondary position. In the Rig Veda, there was no discrimination between women and men and women. There's no gender discrimination. But by the time of the later Vedic civilization, the women were looked down. The women were relegated to the domestic services. The Sudras were relegated to the lower positions, and they were never allowed to acquire knowledge. Whereas in the early Vedic civilization, there was no distinction between the Varna system. And in the Indus Valley civilization also, there were no distinctions based on the birth criterion. So later Vedic civilization, the Brahmanical forces, particularly the priestly class, in conjunction with the Kshatriyas, has established its domination and led to social inequalities and also religious perversion. In the name of puja, in the name of gift, in the name of yagna and yaga, the Brahmins began to acquire wealth. And it led to massive, what you call, violence, killing of the animals, and the overwhelming dominance of the priestly class and the Kshatriyas and the Dvijas caused so much of discontentment in the society. I will not go into the details, but if there is any question, so I'll talk about it. The 6th century BC was a period in which there was so much of socio-cultural turmoil because of the degradation of Brahmanism, because of the social evils that prevailed. For example, the women position was deteriorated, the Sudras were relegated to the lowest position, and the religion has become corrupt, the religious practices have become violent, the Yagnas and the Yagas, in the name of the Yagnas and Yagas, the priestly class accumulated wealth, knowledge, and therefore, there was a kind of a social upheaval against the Brahmanical religion. And therefore, this upheaval was represented by sects, various sects, which were opposed to the Brahmanical religion, Brahmanical philosophy, and the Brahmanical ideology. Brahmanical ideology means inequality, perpetuating the position of the Dvijas, relegating the Sudras and the women, etc. So therefore, against this Brahmanism, a new cult, a new culture has emerged in the form of the Charvakas, Ajvikas, Lokayats, Jains, and Buddhism. So these non-Vedic, non-Brahmanic cultural traditions like Charvakas, Ajvikas, Lokayats, Jains, and Buddhists, they challenged the hegemony and the dominance of the Brahmanical religion and the Brahmanical ideology. And they propounded social equality. They propounded gender equality. They condemned the practices, the corrupt practices in the name of Yaga and Yagna. They condemned the concepts of Papa Punya and Swarga Naraka. And in this context, we must remember, of all the sects that came into existence in the 6th century BC, which challenged the Brahmanical religion, the Sramanism, what Romila Thapar called, the Sramanas, the productive forces, the productive people of the Chaturvarna, they were the ones who rejected the Brahmanical religion. Therefore, in the 6th century BC, we find a conflict between Brahmanism and what Romila Thapar called Sramanism. Sramanism means the productive people, the social group which is involved in the production of the social wealth, and which propagated an ideology which was entirely different and opposed to the Brahmanical religion and Brahmanical culture. And therefore, this egalitarian culture, a culture rooted in what we today call social democracy, social justice, was propagated. And we all know, as Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar has conceptualized, Buddhism was the earliest religion in India which preached social equality, social justice, and social democracy. Therefore, the 6th century BC, Indian civilization has witnessed a kind of a conflict in cultural terms between Brahmanism and Sramanism. And Buddhism became very famous, very popular. I mean, I don't want to go into the details, but suppose it is both Jainism and Buddhism, they became very popular. They became very popular in the entire subcontinent. Both Buddhism and Jainism gained prominence, and they projected gender equality, social equality, condemned the Brahmanical religious traditions, and the Brahmanical textual ideology, Chaturvarna Vyavastha, Vanudharma Shastra, were condemned. And therefore, they preached the principles of social equality and social justice. So therefore, this is one of the important aspects of Indian culture that we must remember. The way that Indian civilization evolved, where the Brahmanism, the classical Vedic Brahmanism, was challenged by the other important religious and cultural traditions, which remain part of Indian culture. Even till today, we have Buddhists, we have Jains, and we have people who propound the philosophy of Charvakas, the Sankhya, the Ajvikas, and so on and so forth. So therefore, in the ancient past, we should remember that by the time of the later Vedic civilization, by the time of the 6th century BC, Indian civilization has become pluralistic. Along with Brahmanism, there existed other religious traditions, other cultural traditions. Along with Vedic religion, Vedic culture, Vedic ideology, the non-Vedic, non-Brahmanical traditions and cultures also flourished. So this was the kind of amalgamation, what I should say, the amalgamation of the various cultures. Along with the Vedic culture, you have the non-Vedic, non-Brahmanic cultures existing in India. And also around that same time, I must also remember that India, as I said, was a country which was exposed to foreign influences. So in political terms, after the end of the 6th century BC, by the time of the establishment of the Mauryan Empire, we find, and even during the post-Mauryan period, we find a lot of foreign invasions into India from Western Asia. The Shakas, the Yavanas, the Kushanas, the Huns, a whole lot of foreign groups, particularly from Central Asia, from China, they came, conquered the country. As we know, Alexander came and defeated the Porus, the king of Northwestern India. And we find the Greek influence on Indian culture in the form of Gandhara art and architecture. So the Greeks came, the Yavanas came, Yavanas means the Greeks, the Shakas came, and the Scythians came, the Parthians came, the Huns came, the Kushanas came. All those invaders who came and conquered different parts of India, what we today call, including Peshawar, Gandhara, or the Kandahar today in Afghanistan, they were all part of this ancient Indian, what you call, empires. So various parts of India were conquered by these foreigners who came and embraced the Indian religious traditions. You know, for example, the Kushana king, Kanishka, for example, he embraced Buddhism. And a number of Parthians who came from Central Asia, they became part of the Brahmanical religion. So they embraced Hinduism, so to speak, Brahmanism, so to speak, because there is no word called Hindu in ancient Indian literature. So therefore, the foreign elements the Scythians, the Parthians, the Kushanas, the Yavanas, the Huns, etc., who came and settled, they brought along with them their cultural traditions, their food habits, their dressing, you know, their warfare tactics, you know, and their cooking, you know, practices, their food habits. And therefore, we find the influence of Greek culture. In architecture, for example, in art and architecture, we clearly find the Gandhara school of art and architecture. So therefore, India, therefore, in ancient times, was a place where different cultures mingled, different different cultural traditions existed, different religious traditions existed. And most of the kings, they followed a kind of a religious tolerance. Of course, by the time of Ashoka, who embraced Buddhism, but he did not discriminate against other religions. So there is a kind of a religious tolerance that was exhibited by the ancient kings, whether it is Kanishka, whether it is Chandragupta Maurya, or whether it is Ashoka. So we find that the ancient tradition, ancient polity, ancient culture, promoting this principle of coexistence, tolerance. There was no persecution of the other religions, for example. Even Guptas, who encouraged Brahmanism, who patronized Sanskrit, who patronized, you know, the Sanskrit scholars. But then, even then, they did not discriminate against other religions, either Jainism or Buddhism or other religious traditions. And the various other sections of the Indian society have freely followed their respective cultural traditions. So therefore, the foundations of a composite culture were very much established in the ancient Indian tradition, in ancient Indian civilization. I think that we must remember. From about, let us say, from the early Vedic period till about the Rajput era, for about 1,000 and odd years, India, Indian civilization witnessed the flourishing of this composite culture, where different cultural traditions, different religious groups coexisted, and there was tolerance. There was give and take. A number of foreigners who came and settled in India, who conquered various parts of India, they settled here and they adopted the indigenous traditions, indigenous cultures, and indigenous, what you call, ethos. And therefore, these foreign elements, whether it is Greek, Hellenistic, or Chinese, or Central Asian, were very much present in the ancient past. Now, coming to the medieval period, I would only like to argue that India was exposed to, just like in the ancient past, in the medieval period also, it was exposed to various other cultures. For example, the major religious tradition, the major religion that came into India in the medieval period was known as Islam from Arabia. Actually, Islam came to India through the traders, the Arab traders, the Arab merchants who brought their commodities and sold in India, particularly in the Malabar coast, you know, and also in Malabar coast, in Bengal coast. And the Arabs, Arab traders came and settled. And in Malabar, for example, in present day Kerala, they married with the local people. So there is a distinct community called Mapilas. The Mapilas are a Muslim community, which was a product of the interaction between Arab male and the local Malayali woman. So the Mapilas were a creation of this cultural interaction between the Arab traders and the local Malayali society. Similarly, after the conquest of Sindh by Muhammad Qasim in 8th century AD, Islam as a religion, as a tradition, as a culture was established on the soil of India. So by the time of the 8th century AD, the Islamic influence could be found, of course, in Sindh, what we today call in Punjab, present-day Pakistan, and also in Malabar coast. But later, Islam became a full-fledged religious tradition. Its impact was felt all over the country after the establishment of the Delhi Sultanate in the medieval period, in the 12th and 13th centuries. That was the peak period when Islam, as a religious tradition, as a political, you know, tradition, existed in India. But India, as I said, just like India invited the Greeks, the Parthians, the Kushans, even Muslims, the Central Asian conquerors like Muhammad Ghori, who established the Delhi Sultanate, and it was followed by the Mughals. They all brought along with them their traditions, their customs, not only their religion, but also tradition and custom. Here I would like to highlight two important things of the medieval culture, the interface between Indian culture and the Islamic culture. Two things I want to identify. I don't have time to go into the details. One is Islam was a democratic religion. At least in Quran, it did not distinguish between different social groups. And it preached a kind of a social equality, just like Buddhism. There's a kind of an element of social democracy, because in the masjid, all are equal. Whereas in a Hindu temple, a Dalit, an so-called untouchable was not allowed. A Sudra was not allowed to worship or to become a priest. But in Islam, social equality is preached. So therefore, it attracted the attention of so many lower castes and communities. And therefore, a lot of conversions have taken place. 90% of the Indian Muslims are drawn from the lower Sudra communities, fishermen communities, semi-nomadic tribes, or even tribal people, because they were discriminated in the so-called Brahmanic religion, and therefore Islam offered them some kind of a, what you call, relief. And Islam also propagated the bhakti, the Sufi movement. Sufism is a kind of a religion which opposed the traditional orthodox Islam propagated by the mullahs, by the priests like the brahmanas. The mullahs and the qazis, they established their domination in the Islamic tradition by interpreting Quran in a partial way, saying that jihad must be the, what you call, sacred duty of all the Muslims. But the Sufi saints, they preached social harmony, communal harmony, religious toleration. And the Sufism came from Arabia. And Sufism became very popular in North India as well as in South India, particularly during the Delhi Sultanate period. In the Deccan, the Bahmani kingdom, the Qutbishahi kingdom, Sufism became very, very popular. And the Sufi tradition, particularly in Deccan, in Telangana, we know how the Dargahs, how the Muharram festival was celebrated. The festivals, the cultural traditions were very much integrating each other's elements. So many Islamic traditions have come into the so-called Indian culture. And more importantly, in the realm of art and architecture, we can see the entire medieval architecture, the Indo-Saracenic, the Indo-Persian architecture, is an amalgamation of Indian and Islamic elements. Music, the Qawwali, for example, the Ghazal, and the paintings, the miniature paintings, and in the fine arts, in music, and in musical instruments, we find this cultural synthesis taking place. So therefore, from about 12th century AD till about the 18th century, till the decline of the Mughals, the entire Indian subcontinent interacted with the Islamic traditions. And so many elements of Islamic tradition have come into being. And we know in Telangana particularly how the Islamic culture has influenced our architecture, our food habits, our dressing habits, your chudidar, paisama, you know, your biryani, your paan, you know, your instruments, your music, they all were the amalgamation of the Islamic Sufi tradition and the Indian cultural traditions. Therefore, the entire medieval period flourished. Similarly, the Bhakti movement, which also flourished in the medieval period, Kabir, Nanak, Ramananda, Mirabai, and all Bhakti saints were equally influenced by Sufism. Similarly, the Sufi saints have taken, amalgamated certain Bhakti traditions. Both Bhakti and Sufi, they condemned religious orthodoxy. The Bhakti saints condemned the Brahmanical priestly domination. The Sufi saints condemned the mullah, the qazi, who propagated this concept of jihad, which means fight against the kafirs. But Sufi said no, Islam and Hinduism must coexist. The traditions, the Islamic tradition and the Indic tradition must flourish side by side. That's what the Sufi saints said, and Sufis became very popular. Sufism became integral part of Indian culture, like the Bhakti saints. These Bhakti saints derived so many elements from Sufism. So Sufism and Bhaktiism became the symbols of composite culture in the medieval times. And coming to the modern period, we find the advent of the British, advent of the Europeans particularly, has brought another important religion to India, that is Christianity. Christianity was, of course, it came in the first century AD, when the famous Saint Thom of the Thomas school of Orthodox Christianity came to India. He landed in Kerala, and also he lived in Tamil Nadu, and therefore the Saint Thomas Church was the earliest church established in India. The first Christian presence was felt in South India, particularly in Kerala and also in Tamil Nadu. But later in the 18th century, later in the 15th century, when Vasco da Gama discovered the sea route to India, the Portuguese brought along with them their religious traditions. Christianity came to India. The Catholic Christians, the Jesuits, and later the Protestants, the British, the Dutch, the French, the Portuguese, all those European companies, powers that came to India, they brought along with them their religion. So therefore, Christianity became an established religion in India. Though it was a religion of the Europeans, but Christianity became very, very popular. Both the Christian Catholic Church as well as the Protestant Church became very, very popular because Christianity preached, Jesus Christ preached tolerance, social justice, concept of social justice. He condemned violence. He condemned the priestly dominance. He condemned the caste system and the practice of untouchability. And therefore, Christianity, through the preachings of the Bible, it was propagated among the lower castes. Again, just as the Muslims who were converted from among the lower castes and communities of India, the 90% of the Christians, 95% of the Christians were drawn from the lower castes and communities. Because, as I said, the Brahmanical Hinduism, the Vedic Sanatana Dharma, it excluded the vast majority of the Indian society. Therefore, the so-called Sudras found certain legitimacy, certain solace in these new religious traditions, whether it is Islam in the medieval period, whether it is Sufism in the medieval period, or Christianity in the modern period. So Christianity became a kind of a religion of the poor, I should say. Though there were some fathers, there were some archbishops, the bishops, they came, some of them, of course, came from Europe, but only very microscopic minority. Just like the Islamic religion, which became the religion of the poor, Christianity became the religion of the poor, because the Sudras, the Atisudras, the women, etc., they were excluded from the mainstream socio-cultural traditions, socio-cultural systems. Neither the temple nor the matha allowed the Sudras and Atisudras to have any access. Brahmanism excluded these sections. Therefore, they found solace. They found a kind of a welcome into the embrace of these new religious traditions. So therefore, Christianity, historically, I know, today 99% of the Christians are drawn from among the Sudra and Atisudra communities. And therefore, modern religion, the Christian religion, as Christianity became very popular in the Indian subcontinent, across the country, north, south, east, west, from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, from Gujarat to Assam, or even, you know, Mizoram, Nagaland, you know, all those areas where Christianity could be seen to have flourished. So there were very few instances of forced conversion, I should say. As a student of history, I know, of course, there were forced conversions here and there, I'm not denying, but they are very, very, very rare. The general principle was that Christianity attracted the common people, the oppressed, the oppressed. So therefore, that's why in the 19th century, the social reformers, particularly Jyotiba Phule, Ramaswamy Periyar Nayakar, Baba Sahib Ambedkar, to name a few, Ayodhyadas, of course, in Tamil Nadu, Narayan Guru in Kerala, they were all influenced by the indigenous religious traditions like Buddhism, Jainism. Ayodhyadas propagated Buddhism. Jyotiba Phule was very much influenced by the thought of Buddha and also Charvakas, Ajvikas, the Bhakti tradition in Maharashtra, the Bhakti tradition was very, very popular. So Jyotiba Phule was the first social revolutionary in modern India who fought against Brahmanism, which was represented by the Peshwas, by the Peshwa rule. So he wanted to establish the Baliraja, Balirajya, as it was symbolized the rule of the oppressed. So Jyotiba Phule propagated anti-caste ideology. In his book, Gulamgiri, you know, he propagated the concept of social justice as propounded by Gautam Buddha. Jyotiba Phule embraced both modernism and also the indigenous tradition. He was influenced by American Revolution. He was influenced by the French Revolution. He read the writings of Thomas Paine. He propagated the rights of man. So Jyotiba Phule became the first modern social revolutionary, not Raja Ramon Rai, though Brahma Samaj was established for this social reform, for the eradication of social evils. But Raja Ramon Rai was confined only to the upper caste, whereas Jyotiba Phule, Ayodhyadas, Narayan Guru, and Baba Sahib Ambedkar, he has elaborated the anti-caste ideology as propounded by the Charvakas, by the Ajvikas, by the Buddhists. And therefore, the anti-caste tradition, the anti-caste ideology has become a guiding principle of all the 19th century social reformers. Here in Telangana, we know a number of social reformers have articulated social equality. And in South India, the Ramaswamy Periyar Nayakar was the champion of the Dravidian liberation, Ayodhyadas, and a number of social reformers in the 19th century, including, as far as the women's liberation was concerned, Savitribai Phule. She truly represented the spirit of Buddhism, where when Gautama Buddha declined the gender inequality, Savitribai Phule upheld the women's liberation. She became the founder of the women's liberation movement in India. Of course, along with her, a number of other reformers, social reformers, have continued the tradition. But what I'm trying to suggest is, in the ancient tradition, the social protest ideology, the social protest consciousness, the anti-caste ideology, as it was propagated by the Ajvikas, by the Charvakas, by the Lokites, by the Buddhists and the Jains, was carried through the medieval period, through the Bhakti saints, through the Sufi saints, and in the modern period, Christianity and the social reform ideology of Jyotiba Phule and Baba Sahib Ambedkar, because these are the two important personalities who influenced the anti-caste movements, the Dalit liberation movements in India. Therefore, what I would like to suggest is that this cultural ethos, incorporating the elements from outside, as I said, you know, just like the Greeks, the Yavanas, the Shakas, the Parthians, the Kushans, brought along with them their traditions and customs and what you call habits. Similarly, in the medieval period, the Islamic traditions, Islamic customs, Islamic food habits, Islamic art and architecture, Islamic music has influenced the Indians. Like Sufism and Bhakti movement represented this cultural synthesis. And in the modern period, Christianity as well as the social reform has reflected this cultural, what you call, synthesis. The amalgamation of different cultural ethos, values, and the essence. And that's why India remained a composite culture. And this, the roots of the composite culture are very much late during the ancient past. They were continued through the medieval and the modern period. Today in the contemporary period, we are witnessing, we are reaping the fruits, the benefits of these cultural ethos and these cultural values. And therefore, in the future, I'm sure the ethos and the values of the composite culture will flourish. So I thank you all for your patient hearing. If you have got any doubts, any questions, we can, you know, spend some 5 to 10 minutes. Thank you, Nagar, for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. You have made us to forget the time. A wonderful lecture and wonderful observations on Indian history. Not only the title that talks about the evaluation of Indian composite culture, and you started lecturing on the different things and inequalities that were done in the ancient history and how the history was misunderstood sometime and how history was misinterpreted sometime. And in your lecture, you have spoken about the composite nature of Indian culture and the amalgamation of Indian culture, how it looks like. Yes, the diversity. Indian culture, never it was like homogeneous. It was like right from 6th century BC to the Middle Ages and then modern ages. It has been the composite culture, and it has the characteristics like pluralism and all the things. Thank you very much, sir, for your wonderful observations and your extensive reading and writing, certainly. And it is an example. Your ideas are an example for your wonderful and thought-provoking lecture. Now I invite the scholars and the teachers of the department and of the university. Here, Dr. Christopher from English department, Dr. Anjaya from History department, and many scholars, Dr. Pratibha Mukherjee from Kolkata University, and many teachers working at different universities across the country are here. Now it's open for discussion, observation, clarifications. I welcome you.
So Dr. Christopher has a point.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. Nice to yes, hear your lecture. Okay, it was very interesting. No, I don't have a question. I just was saying hi to you, sir.
Yes.
I don't have a question.
Thank you.
Sir, we have received a question in the chat box.
Yes.
Yes, sir. From our department scholar.
Yes.
Sir, may I know your opinion on the term Hindu Rashtra, as for what to expect when it was said that India would become Hindu Rashtra by 2025?
Yes, as I said, you know, this concept of Hindu Rashtra, that is identifying Indian culture, identifying Indian civilization, identifying Indian ethos with one religion, that is Hinduism. That is, of course, Hindus are in the majority. 80% of the population are Hindus. But it doesn't mean Indian culture is Hindu culture. Along with Hinduism, other religious traditions, cultures also existed in India. As I said, right from the ancient times, the very word Hindu did not occur in the entire Vedic literature. There is no word called Hindu in Ramayana Mahabharata or in Puranas or in Upanishads. The term Hindu, actually, it was used by the Islamic people. When the Muslims interacted with India, when the Arabs interacted with, particularly Arabs, I must say, when the Arabs interacted with India, they identified India as Al-Hind. In the 8th century AD, when the Arabs conquered Sindh province, they called it Al-Hind. So this Al-Hind, the people who lived in the Hind, they called as Hindus. Now it is an irony, sir, some of those champions of Hinduism or Hindu Rashtra using a term which was coined by the Arabs, not by the, you know, Sanatana Dharma. In Bhagavad Gita, there is no term called Hindu. In Ramayana Mahabharata, there is no term called Hindu. In Vedas, there is no word called Hindu. They borrowed, they imitate this word called Hindu, because Hindu means, of course, when the Arabs identified the ethnic people of India as Alhind, they called them Hindus. But the culture that existed in India at that time, the culture that existed, as I said, was not only identified just with Hindus or Hinduism. There were elements of Islam. There were elements of Buddhism. There were elements of Jainism. And also there's so many other religions, non-Vedic religions, non-Hindu religions. You know, the tribe, Adivasis of India, for example, they don't follow so-called Hinduism. The Adivasis have their own cultural traditions, their own value system, their own, you know, political system. They don't subscribe to what you call the Hinduism as such. They were never called Hindus. So the entire Adivasi world was different. Similarly, there are a number of traditions which are present in India, which are not necessarily identified with Hindus at all. So therefore, the identification of religious identity with cultural identity is not advisable. It is not historically true. Indian culture has never been Hindu culture. Of course, Hindus are in majority, no doubt about it. There is no legitimacy to Hindu Rashtra. It is just like, you know, you are denying the other religious traditions, other cultures. You want to make the Muslims as a secondary people, or Christians as a secondary people, or Adivasis as a secondary people, or Dalits. Because Dalits are, you know, they are nowhere Hindus as such. If Hindu is defined as one who goes and prays in the temple, Dalits have been never allowed into the temples from Vedic times till now, even till today. It is some Hindu temples, Hindu priests, they don't allow Dalits. How can a Dalit feel, you know, that is a part of Brahmin? How can a Muslim, you know, feel that he is a part of Hinduism as such? So therefore, it is not historical to equate our cultural tradition, our religion, our civilization with Hindu. So therefore, there is no question of, you know, establishing. I mean, it may be a political project. I'm not sure whether that political project of Hindu Rashtra, because we condemn Pakistan because Pakistan was declared as an Islamic state. But we know our constitution doesn't declare India as a Hindu Rashtra. Our constitution is a secular constitution. Our constitution provides certain fundamental rights, religious freedoms. So therefore, you cannot impose your dharma or your religious belief on the rest of the Indian people, on Christians or on Muslims or Adivasis or Dalits, etc. So therefore, of course, they may think of Hindu Rashtra, creating a Hindu Rashtra, but that Hindu Rashtra is nothing to do with the cultural ethos of Indian civilization, the cultural values of the Indian civilization. As I said, religious pluralism is the hallmark of Indian civilization. We have Buddhists, we have Jains, we have Christians, we have Islamic people, and we have non-Hindu, non-Vedic religious traditions, the Adivasis, for example. No, the Adivasis do not subscribe to the what you call the Hindu tradition as such. So they may identify with some of the Hindu gods and goddesses, Rama, Bhima, you know, Arjuna, etc. But it doesn't mean that that you impose your concept of religious identity on non-Hindus. So therefore, it may be a political project, but in civilizational terms, as a student of history, I don't accept that concept. Otherwise, what is the difference between us and what is happening today in Afghanistan or in Pakistan? Because our constitution is a secular constitution. Our constitution embodies the values of composite culture: freedom, equality, justice. So our constitution doesn't talk about Hinduism our constitution doesn't talk about Hindu religion. Our constitution talks about religious freedom. Yes, our constitution gives freedom to all religions. All are equal before the law. All religions are equal before the constitution. There is no special privilege to Hinduism or to Islam or to Christian. No, there is no special treatment to Hinduism or to the Hindus. Hindus or Brahmins or Dalits, everybody is equal before the law. If a Brahmin commits a crime, he will be given the same punishment if a Dalit commits the same crime. But in Manodharma, if the Brahmin commits a sin, commits a crime, he is given a differential treatment in Manodharma Shastra. If the Brahmin kills a person, he was just excused. But if a Dalit kills, he was killed. That is Manodharma. But our constitution is not Manodharma. Our constitution is secular constitution. Our constitution is scientific constitution. Our constitution is based on the principles of, you know, freedom and equality and fraternity, as Baba Saheb Ambedkar has enshrined this provision. Therefore, our constitution does not give any privileges to Hindus. No. Just because you are a Hindu, just because you are in a majority, you don't have any extra constitutional power or extra constitutional privileges. Of course, there are reservations. You know, there are provisions of what you call social, you know, advancement. But that is irrespective of religion, caste, and community. Our constitution always speaks of irrespective of religion, irrespective of caste and community. So therefore, religion, caste, and community does not find any place. Therefore, Hindu Rashtra is not a constitutionally, you know, accepted category. Thank you, sir.
We have received another question. It is like, it has been answered by you, sir, already, by Professor Mukherjee from Kolkata University. Hindu Rashtra in 21st century India has certain political implications. Can we deny that?
No, of course, you know, you're right. You know, he's right. Because today, some political parties, they are propagating this ideology of Hindu dominance, imposing the Hindu way of life, you know, and imposing the Hindu value system, denying the others, persecuting the others by using extra constitutional powers. You know, we have seen how in North India, the lynching of the Muslims in the name of cow protection has been happening. That is not, you know, of course, if anybody commits any crime, the constitution has given some provisions for punishment. But you can't punish, you know, take the law into your own hands and punish the others. So it is true, some political parties are propagating this idea of Hindu superiority, you know, of Hindu right, of Hindu domination. So they think the minorities, they should be, you know, like secondary, second grade citizens of this country. Yes, there are some ideologues, you know, we know some of the writings of some of those ideologies, like Golwalkar, V.D. Savarkar, who propounded this concept of Hindutva. So it defines Indian civilization only as Hindu civilization. It identifies Hindi culture as Indian culture with Hindu culture. Of course, they are you know, propagating that ideas, such ideas. But such ideas cannot be imposed on the others as per the Indian constitution. Indian constitution, we are governed by Indian constitutional law. The Indian constitution is supreme. Whatever is prescribed in the constitution will be upheld by the courts, by the judiciary, by the police, and, you know, by the legislation. You may talk about establishing your own domination, but so long as it is not constitutional, it will be opposed. So it will unnecessarily create these communal tensions. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your detailed explanation for the questions. Yeah. Now